support is provided by the Children's Hospital of Southwest Florida, part of the Lee Memorial Health System. Caring people, caring for people.
Hi, I'm Cody.
I'm Tyler.
I'm Riley.
And I'm Kyra. We're the hosts of Curious Kids. Welcome to our treehouse.
Did you know that Southwest Florida is home to one of the most incredible places on Earth, the Everglades National Park?
Yeah, the Everglades are the largest wilderness in the continental United States and a World Heritage Site.
What exactly does that mean?
It means that it's been identified as one of the special places on Earth that's of outstanding value to humanity.
Amazing! And that's right here in our own backyard.
Yep, so today we're going to find out why it's such an extraordinary place.
And see how it connects from our backyard
to the world.
And right back to ourselves and you.
Starting off with a very cool ride on an airboat.
A really cool way to see the Everglades is on an airboat. The folks at Wharton's Airboat near Everglades City kindly hosted us on one of their boats. Miss Tracy was our captain. Because the airboat engine is really loud, we had to wear headsets. That made it really difficult to hear anyone talking to you. Okay, all aboard and off we go. Our airboat slowly picked up speed as we began our journey through the river of grass. The flat bottom design of the boat allows it to travel easily through the shallow waters. The first airboat, called the Ugly Duckling, was built over 100 years ago in Nova Scotia, Canada, by Dr. Alexander Graham Bell, who also invented the telephone. Airboats are used in cold climates to travel across the ice.
Homemade airboats arrived in the swamps and marshes of Southwest Florida about 80 years ago. The cage on the back helps protect the propeller from objects flying into them.
Mangrove swamps cover all of the western and southern coasts of the Everglades. They protect the land from rising waters and hurricanes.
We didn't see a lot of wildlife during our airboat ride, probably because we were traveling so fast and the boat's really noisy. But these boats can get you into remote places where you can cut the engine and quietly observe some of the animals that make their home in the Everglades National Park.
We only saw one other boat when we were out there. We thought our boat captain, Miss Tracy, has a pretty cool job. If you ever get a chance to take an airboat ride, we think you'll enjoy it.
Our morning adventures left us pretty hungry, so we stopped off at the Oyster House in Everglades City to meet one of the owners, Mr. Bob Miller Jr.
Hey guys, nice to see you.
I'm Cody.
Glad you came. Hey,
I'm
Cody.
Callie.
Hey, Callie, how you doing? You ready to go cook in the kitchen?
Yeah.
All right, let's go. Let's do it. All right, guys, are you ready? We got all different types of gator to cook today. We have a hamburger, we're gonna do fried, and we're gonna do our saute, the island style.
Wait a minute, did he say gator?
He did! We were going to be eating alligator for lunch. That's definitely local food.
We'll do the hamburger first because this takes the longest out of all the cooking. We'll put that on there. Now we're gonna do the sauteed gator. We have it a little warm here. And we shake it up in there. We let that start to cook.
What is the best part or best meaty part of the gator that is
well, being cooked? The filet mignon of the gator is the tail. That's the best meat. It's the sweetest. It's the tenderest. It's actually in the middle. There's some meat around it, and it actually is a tenderloin, just like beef. Wow. It looks like very similar to that. Next, who wants to hand me the fried gator? We'll get that going. You know, when you cook, you have to make sure everything comes out hot. So we're staging all our food so it all comes out at about the same time. We're gonna take a look at the saute gator, see how it's doing.
Yep.
We just turn it around, let all the seasoning get incorporated in.
Mr. Bob flipped the gator burgers, checked the fried gator, then it was time to prepare the plates. An important part of serving food in a restaurant is creating a beautiful plate.
We're all done there. Good job, guys. Let's put it up here, and we'll bring it out. All right. Excellent job.
Even though we watched it all being cooked, it seemed like a lot of food when Mr. Bob served it up at our table. But we were hungry.
Who would have ever thought that alligator would taste this good?
So good.
Before we left, we had to try one last thing.
I would not want to be in the jaws of this beast.
Me neither.
Wow.
Down in the swamps and the rivers and lakes of the Florida countryside, There's a creature whose bones, nets, and tails have shaped and molded this land. She's not what you call the most glamorous gal, but oh, what a mother is she, who makes her nest with meticulous care, warm and snug as can be. Oh, the alligator rocks and the alligator rolls as she watches the world go by. Floating still like a big green launch, she can catch you in the twinkle of an eye. Oh, the alligator rocks and the alligator rolls as she watches the world go by. Floating still like a big green launch, she can catch you in the twinkle of an eye.
Now let's check out the small wood store. Hi, I'm Cody.
Hi, I'm Mallory. Nice to meet you.
Hi, I'm Callie.
Nice
so,
to meet you.
Did you actually grow up here?
Yeah, I grew up here my whole life. My grandfather opened the store. It was a trading post. He had his family here. He used the store as a way to provide for his family, and he also helped the locals out. He would trade with them groceries for hide and alligator hide and other stuff like that. And it was also a U.S. post office. Yeah. That's my grandfather, and that's my grandmother. That's his wife, and that's the sister.
Miss Mallory gave us a list of things to find in the store, kind of like a treasure hunt. So off we went.
When was the Smallwood store established?
Let's see. Oh, right there. See, Ted's Smallwood operation was moved to the present location at the water's edge in 1917.
1917, there you go.
Number two, what is a swamp angel? Is it A, a mosquito, B, a fly, or C, a frog?
There it is, A mosquito. What does Chokoloski mean in Seminole language?
Well, let's see if it's...
It's not over
no,
here.
No, it isn't. Let's see if it's in another part of the store.
There was a lot of stuff in that store. It was cool to see everyday items that we use today in their original form, from spoons to irons.
Yeah, they are.
Wow, that's pretty cool. Whoa! They say it's a megalodon prehistoric shark tooth. That must have been a big fish.
Yeah.
Still no number three, Chokoloski.
Chokoloski, old house.
There we go.
Oh, and look, Okeechobee means big water, Lake Okeechobee.
Yeah,
in Tallahassee, old town. Okay, question number four. What is another name for the mangrove? The banyan tree, the walking tree, the running tree, or the guava? Well, maybe we should go look around. Let's try out here.
Oh, look, there's the answer to the next question.
It says, land of the walking tree.
We should have known that one. We learned it on our last show. You have to wonder how Mr. Smallwood kept track of everything in this store. I guess someone had a really long list. We signed the guest register, said goodbye and thanks to Miss Mallory, then took time to skim a few stones before heading out.
The original Everglades date back 5,000 years and used to reach from Orlando to Florida Bay.
60 years ago, in an effort to protect this unique ecosystem, Everglades National Park was created.
Did you ever wonder why it's called the Everglades?
Yeah, how did it get its name?
Ever from the word forever and glades from the old English word that means grassy open place. The Native Americans who lived there called it Pahayoki, which means grassy waters.
The Everglades are home to hundreds of birds and animals. When you visit the park, you might see birds like the great blue heron, which has a wingspan of 6 feet.
The Everglades is one of the only places you can find the American alligator and the American crocodile.
Can you tell the difference between them? The alligator has a U-shaped snout, and the crocodile snout is V-shaped.
Alligators live in freshwater, while the American crocodile prefers saltwater, so you're most likely to find them near the coast.
There are believed to be about 10 to 15 of the endangered Florida panthers living in the park, but they are very shy and so hard to see.
Finally, there is one little insect that thrives in the wetlands of the Everglades. Can you guess what it is? Here's a hint. The male feeds on the nectar of flowering plants, while the female sucks the blood of mammals like us.
Mosquito, a mosquito. You got it, the mosquito.
Luckily, there aren't many mosquitoes around during the cooler winter months. So why not head out and explore one of the most unique places on Earth, right here in our backyard, the Florida Everglades.
Mosquito, oh mosquito,
your blood, you know well. One, two, three, three, two, one. She liked to whine, she liked to hum.
She goes, ay, 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 ay.
When exotic pets like pythons or iguanas are let loose into the wild, they can cause a lot of trouble to native species.
Called invasive exotics, these animals thrive in the subtropical climate of Southwest Florida, and it's hard to control them from spreading, especially in the places like the Everglades.
To learn more, Cody and Riley visited the Calusa Nature Center in Fort Myers. It's a really cool place where they take care of some of the exotic animals that have been captured by wildlife experts.
Miss Melinda.
Miss Melinda is a volunteer at the center, and she's passionate about animals, even the ugly and dangerous ones.
The first creature we got to meet was Bananas.
Bananas is a Burmese python and is an exotic invasive species. And the reason they're such a problem is because they can get very, very large. Bananas here can get to be 20 feet long. And what happens is somebody will have them as a pet and they don't realize how much a big snake is going to eat. So if you have a big snake like that, sometimes they tend to be aggressive feeders.
Yes.
So if you have an 18-foot snake and he's hungry and he strikes at you, that's not only terrifying, it can be very dangerous.
Riley and Bananas seem to really hit it off. Then it was time to put him away.
All right, we're going to put this snake away, and then after that, do you want to see something really ugly?
Okay, this cane toad definitely needs a kiss from a princess. He is ugly, but you won't get any warts from touching him. However, you do want to wash your hands if you touch one, because they produce a poisonous fluid.
Your average dog and cat doesn't know how to react to the poison glands, so they'll attack him and bite him, and they can get blindness, paralysis, and death.
Yeah, see those pores?
Mm-hmm.
When he feels threatened or freaked out, he'll go ahead and excrete like a white substance that's basically like a poison. So a lot of times other animals won't eat them because, one, they don't taste good, and two, sometimes that poison will react with the other animals and it sometimes will kill them.
Cane toads are native to Central and South America, not Florida. They were first introduced here to help control pests in sugarcane fields. Then, 50 years ago, 100 specimens were accidentally released from a pet dealer's stock, and they quickly spread across the state.
Wind up being a problem themselves because they do eat everything. They eat the other froglets, they produce faster, they produce more babies, so it's quickly they take right over in an area, and they'll just start spreading out, trying to look for more and more food to eat.
Next, we meet a giant green iguana. He was big. They can really hurt you with their tails and give you a nasty bite. So if you find one, be careful.
What are the spikes for, like?
The spikes basically just show you that he's mostly male. Males get the big spikes and they get the big dewlap sac right there. Females, they don't get the big spikes like that and they don't get the big dewlap sac. That's just to help him look really cool.
Green iguanas are reptiles native to Central and South America. They were first introduced to Florida as pets, though it is believed that the very first ones were stowaways on boats. Now, large populations roam Florida, causing damage to vegetation and bird populations because they eat eggs from nests.
Finally, we got to meet some very cute little pigs. But don't be fooled, these adorable babies soon grow big and cause a lot of damage to our local ecosystems by eating up all the vegetation.
So every 6 to 7 months, they can have 6 to 7 to 10 babies.
Wow.
And they'll just keep having more. And again, these don't have any real natural enemies here, so they're not gonna have things eating them as much.
Exotic animals are amazing, but releasing them into the wild where they don't belong not only causes a lot of damage, it's against the law. If you have an exotic pet and you no longer want to keep it, please call a wildlife refuge center. Don't let it go.
Better you than me, Riley. Holding that snake?
I like snakes. They're amazing animals.
Yeah, but those invasive animals are causing a lot of problems out in the Everglades.
I know. It's because everything is so interconnected. And when one thing gets out of balance, it messes up everything else.
It's true. Because the Everglades are geographically situated at the place where temperate North America meets tropical Caribbean, that means many of the plants and animals from both climates can live there.
We thought it'd be very cool to go on a swamp walk on the edge of the Everglades. Some of us were lucky enough to join photographer Clyde Butcher on a trek into the Big Cypress National Preserve, where he has his home and gallery.
What happens here in the Big Cypress, you have all this grass, and the grass is what's filtering the water. When the water's running in the summertime, it's crystal clear. By end of July, it's raining every day. So the whole thing is running, the water's running. The grass will be tilted like this.
Oh, cool.
So it's actually filtering everything that way.
Along with the rain come the mosquitoes, so we decided to do our swamp walk in November.
And I have a feeling the Indians follow the seasons too. Like right now, there's more mosquitoes down the mangroves than there are here. So the Indians probably came here in the wintertime and came, so they followed where the mosquitoes weren't.
10,000 years ago, this was all ocean. In fact, there were coral reefs right here.
Old Cypress is big, well, you might call it a sponge, where it's all rock, but it's hollow. So the water's going through these caverns and caves and such.
Well, look at this.
Whoa. What is it?
Well, it's like a crawfish. It's one of the favorite things for birds to eat. And what's happened, the water's gone down. He couldn't get back to the water. And a bird didn't get to him in time to eat him. A little lobster.
Next, we found a little snake.
It's probably a little garter snake. Is that right, Johnny?
Yeah, a ribbon snake.
Yeah. Oh, look at him. He wants to say hello.
His tongue's coming out. He's checking you guys out.
Yeah.
Whoa. Ooh.
Then there was this little guy, a kind of millipede that lives under leaves and logs.
Million legs.
Okay, let's head on down the trail.
What is this called?
Well, this is called a bladderwort.
It's a pretty little flower.
Oh, yeah, they're really pretty. Yeah. But what this does is it gets all rid of the mosquito larva when the water's up.
How?
Actually eats it. It's a carnivorous plant.
Oh, wow. Really?
Yep.
Like a Venus flytrap?
Is this it? Yep, exactly like a Venus flytrap. Yep, except a smaller version.
Yeah.
It's amazing how everything works together in an ecosystem. It's all important.
This is called periphyton. This is the heart of the Everglades right here. Without this, it wouldn't be Everglades.
Really?
What happens now, I don't know if you can feel it, but it's still moist.
Yeah.
Can you feel it?
Yeah.
See, everything else around here is dry. Well, the fish and the frogs and the little lobster things lay their eggs in this.
There's a little egg.
So when the water comes back, they hatch.
Periphyton is a complex community of microscopic organisms, especially algae, that are adapted to remove tiny bits of nutrients from the water. In addition to being the foundation of the Everglades, it creates ideal conditions that promote limestone making. This limestone slowly builds up over time, thus creating new land in a similar fashion to the coral, building reefs.
We were getting deeper and deeper into the swamp, and it was getting muddier and muddier, and whoa, that was fun.
The swamp is an awesome place, and there are definitely echoes of ancient times. It feels mysterious and unknown. Oh, and speaking of mysteries.
I heard that there's some kind of monster out in the Everglades. Is that true?
Well, they call it the skunk ape. There's an abominable snowman and such. Now, you think about it. If there was a creature like this, it's supposed to be a big guy, like 7.5 feet tall, big feet, not smells too good, furry. Now, look through here. Do you think you could get lost in here? We've had footsteps up on our patio, big old muddy footsteps. So you just never know.
Finally, our own muddy feet took us out of the forest.
You want to go back?
No.
I want to go back to the mud. What's this?
Well, this is my little toy camera that I use.
Oh, that's your camera.
Mr. Clyde is internationally famous for his black and white photos of the Everglades, and he uses a rather unique camera to take these photos. That's an exact replica of ones made back in the 1800s, with a few improvements.
He told us that he didn't have any lessons in photography. He just started to do it. But why black and white?
When I first started photographing, I photographed in color. But there's so much color. This is what's called black and white film. That the color was so distracting, you couldn't see the scene. So I felt that black and white, you could see the textures, you can see everything. So I'm saying with my photography, it makes one with nature. There's nothing more important. If you like blue, you'd see the blue sky. If you like green, you'd see the green plants. But with the black and white, it becomes one.
The Golisano Children's Museum of Naples will be opening in February 2012. Mr. Joe Cox, the executive director, invited us on a quick tour to give us a sneak peek at how it's all coming together.
This is the street. This is the first exhibit in the whole museum. So from up here, we'll be deep in the Everglades, looking down into the Everglades swamp. This whole place gets filled with alligators and panthers, and we'll go following in all of the animals' footprint. Let's go to the beach. So this will be the beach. I'm standing, if you look all around me, I'm standing right inside a giant seashell. It's 9 feet tall and 22 feet wide. Well, as we all know, there are four seasons. There's summer, fall, winter, and spring. And here at Mother Nature's house, we're going to explore all four. It's good, isn't it?
The Republic of Chile is a South American country that lies between the Andes Mountains and the Pacific Ocean. It is the longest, narrowest country in the world. Hi, I'm Jasmine Rodriguez, a Curious Kids Ambassador. I'm not from Chile, but I love to travel and hope to go there one day. Chile is far away from Florida and has some very different climates. In the north of the country is believed to be the world's driest desert, the Atacama. In the subarctic south, there are ice fields and glaciers. Oh, did I mention volcanoes? There are quite a few of those. The Lahanati National Monument Park in the south of Chile is a protected wetland, like the Florida Everglades. One of my favorite animals lives in Chile. The llama is one of the four species known as the New World Camelids, which inhabit the high mountains of the South American Andes. Yes, they're related to the camel, although they do not have a hump. Originally domesticated by the indigenous Quechua people, llamas were almost destroyed in the early 1500s with the Spanish conquest of that region because the Spanish replaced them with sheep. Alpacas are famous for their fine hair, and the wild herds of vicuña and guanacos are now protected. There's a lot more to learn about Chile, but I'm out of time. Next, we're off to go make South American siku pipes with Riley and Raphael. Bye!
It's Miss Lance's music class at Edison Park Creative Art School in Fort Myers, and the kids are going to be making siku pipes.
Siku pipes, or pan pipes, as they are sometimes called, originally came from the Aymara indigenous people who lived in the Andes Mountains of Peru, Chile, and Bolivia. The largest siku pipe has every note from A to G, but those pipes were difficult for the women to carry as they traveled down from the mountains, and so they would play smaller pipes.
The siku pipes the kids are making will have six notes. The first step is to paste glue onto the pieces of colored paper. Next, the paper is rolled up into a tube. Each colored tube will be a different note. When all the tubes are ready, the next stage is to attach small pieces of black paper onto one end of each tube.
After you've finished your squares and they dry overnight, then I will really test them. I'm going to see if they make a sound or not. If you put enough glue, swished it like we talked about, and put the pressure on for 2 minutes, it should make a really good sound. All right, here's this one. Works fine.
The squares are then trimmed so that they are round like the tubes, and then the tubes are trimmed to determine which note they will play.
And tuning them is kind of a tricky thing because you want to make sure that you trim just the exact amount so it's equal to the note that you want it to sound.
The shorter the tube, the higher the note.
Finally, the tubes are lined up in order of notation and attached to a piece of wood. Then they are ready to play. Raphael and I got to go and play the finished siku pipes. Miss Lance taught us a Peruvian folk song. It took a bit of getting used to. Finally, we got it. Well, sort of. The real siku flute playing sounds like this. Looks like those kids are having some fun.
Get up, get out, get active.
the park is not only fun, it helps keep us fit.
You just need a few friends, some easy game ideas, and off you go.
And when it comes to healthy snacks, Jake and Raphael have a good idea. Here we are at Estero Community Park, ready to have some fun with the Curious Kids Ambassadors.
Starting off with volleyball.
Next, it was time for a game of tag. There are many versions of tag played by children all over the world.
We decided to play pickpocket tag. Each player has a band of cloth in their back pocket, and then players try to grab each other's band without having their own band taken. Red light, green light is another game that gets everyone running. The person who is it has their back turned to the players. When they shout green light, everyone tries to run and touch them.
But when they shout red light, everyone has to stop.
If it sees anyone moving, they have to go back to the start line. This goes on until someone touches it. The trick is to move smoothly so you can stop quickly.
Finally, a run up the hill gave us a great workout. I know there aren't too many hills in Florida, so might as well take advantage of this one.
Do you ever get hungry between meals? I know I do.
I sure do. We put together a recipe for a snack that we think is pretty tasty.
This is how we make our Curious Kids trail mix. Oh, and it's easy to pack for school or for a hike.
We start off with some different nuts like almonds, cashews, pecans, and pistachios. Oopsies.
Then we add in some dried fruits, apricots, raisins, and banana chips.
Then we put in some nice puffed corn because it's nice and crunchy.
And just because we want a little extra something, we add in some chocolate chips.
And then we shake it up and it makes the most delicious trail mix we know.
And to find out just how healthy it is for us, let's ask Miss Betsy.
Thanks, Jake and Raphael. I know I always go a-hunting for a healthy snack between meals. And why buy a snack from the store when it's so easy to make them at home? You can, of course, add whatever ingredients you like. But in this trail mix, we like to go outside the box and try something new. Nuts are very healthy, filling, and nutritional, with so many varieties such as almonds, Brazil nuts, cashews, pecans, and pistachios, you're sure to find a nut that you'll be nuts about. Nuts are a heart-healthy fat that also contain protein, vitamin E, vitamin B2, and fiber, but be sure to always buy the unsalted variety. Why not get a full fruit serving in your snack with some delicious and sweet dried fruit to satisfy those taste buds and deliver a nutritional punch? Last but not least, who doesn't love chocolate? Make it dark chocolate and you can add a boost of antioxidants to this delicious snack.
Curious Kids Trail Mix, yum, I'm gonna try making that.
You could take it on your next swamp trip.
Yeah, I could have used it on that trip.
I wonder if there really is a skunk ape.
Nobody knows for sure, but it is a very mysterious place. Let's hope the Everglades can be preserved for a long, long time.
I want to go to Chile. I love those llamas.
I know, me too.
So much to see and do on this incredible planet, starting right here in Southwest Florida.
See you next time.